This is the Royal Garden Hotel in Kensington, London. And behind these doors are television camera crews from all over the world. NBC, ABC, CBC, even the BBC. One floor up, we've got Belgian television. Two floors down, for all I know, it could be Lithuanian cable television. But they're all here to interview the Rolling Stones, who are in town to pick up a special Grammy Award for their lifetime's achievement. They're also here to promote a new album being made for a new record company. And the questions they'll be trying to answer will be the ones they've been faced with for the best part of 25 years.
I've done about eight.
Well, so I understand, because you got here early.
No, on time, 49.
One takes you to Japan, the other one is to take you to Germany.
Yeah,
one takes you upstairs to America. Ready now, are they? She's not actually working.
The question, what about the future? I mean, are the Stones, firstly, are you going to stay together, do you think?
Yeah, I think so. At least, you know, first off, I hope so. Yeah, and, like I said, where am I going to find another load of mates now, you know? Where am I going to find a drummer like Charlie Watts?
So who's that? You're just talking
Japanese?
In English, presumably.
In English, they've all been in English, apart from the French.
You do French, you're French.
Yeah, the French were funny, because they were funny. It's funny.
So what is it now, the party?
I don't know parties. What is it now?
232, second floor.
Who's it?
American.
So what was that one?
I don't know, hurry up, Ron's dying for a slash.
It's all right, you can say that. What was that?
Said it. Good morning, America.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America.
Yeah.
And what are you going to now?
I don't know, it's good night, Taiwan. Eh?
You can probably take a choice, actually. I think we've got Holland down here, or France.
Oh, great.
Must be America.
And what motivates you to go out and get on the boards again?
Bill.
I mean,
Bill.
Besides Bill.
Just keeping.
Just to see if I
motivated.
Can still dance out there and yeah. Still the sweat and get the crowd going. You know.
Can't imagine Bill Wyman dancing. What a horrific thought.
What do you mean? Every tour, mate.
Really?
He dances all over the stage. Oh, that's Mick.
Oh, that's Mick, isn't it?
No, Mick's the bass player.
What?
I thought he was
the one that... He just stands there as your favourite undertaker, don't you remember?
Bill and Ronnie have done Australia. And if we give him Keith or... This is terrible. That's all. And if I give him, they do Keith or Mick.
Yeah.
Molly will be happy.
Okay, we must get the Italians covered because they've had absolutely... Nobody.
Do you actually enjoy this, doing it production line style like this? Do you say the same things to everybody?
No, we've been doing this for 20 years. We can dream up 15 different answers to the same question.
But you do get asked the same questions?
Oh, yeah.
What's the most popular question?
Are you going
How
on the road?
Come? Yeah.
I think that's where you're going to be.
Charlie, let's see a bit of scarf, please.
Yeah,
a bit of the jacket
scarf.
Underneath.
Yeah. What's underneath the coat? You're doing great. Can you... All right, go on, keep that.
Sorry about the pastel again, Keith.
Oh, you can keep up the pattern, mate.
All right. Can I just do one more? Can you just
That's it, fine. Come across a little bit more. No, just got. We're going to put another film in, mate.
Yeah,
come on. That's it. Good, mate.
Mike was English.
That's fine. Super.
Yes.
Mark English. That's a name
I've heard. Thanks very much. Yeah. Close up.
Yeah, right. So, what songs are we playing tonight on the Grammys?
Where's the blues?
Roll over, mate.
Ladies and gentlemen, have your attention, please. When we come out of this commercial break,
surely.
There's going to be a film montage, the Rolling Rolling Stones.
Just near the time.
And then the presentation is going to be made. During the presentation, could we have quiet, please?
Over the years, the Recording Academy has had the honor of presenting its Lifetime Achievement Award to people such as Frank Sinatra, Ella Fitzgerald, Duke Ellington, Elvis Presley, and last year's recipient, Leonard Bernstein. It is my privilege to present the first of these to a group whose impact upon contemporary music has been felt over nearly a quarter of a century and shows no sign of diminishing so far. They are, in fact, the Rolling Stones.
When it goes like, you'll go dead quiet.
Yeah, completely quiet. He won't say anything.
Sorry,
when you give it to him, he'll go all humble.
Yeah, totally humble. Suddenly,
Mr. Humility.
From the Roof Garden Club in central London, would you please welcome a legendary guitarist and rock performer, Mr. Eric Clapton.
I'm here tonight to provide an example of the cruelty of Mick and Keith's sense of humour. You see, they know how useless I am at this sort of thing.
Nevertheless, I'm very proud to be chosen to give this award to them because they're very dear friends of mine, and as far as I'm concerned, they are what rock and roll is all about. Toughness and relentless to the very end. Anyway, let me read the sentiment here from the trustees. It says, "This trustees award is presented to the Rolling Stones, the most volatile and intact rock group to survive the 60s, and a band that has grown and changed musically and lyrically with society's dynamics. Influenced by some of America's earliest and greatest rhythm and blues artists, Mick Jagger, Keith Richard, Bill Wyman, Charlie Watts, Brian Jones and Ron Wood introduced this music first to their native England and then to the rest of the world, pouring the foundation for modern pop and rock performers and writers to build their careers."
Don't try and play.
And then we got three.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
God bless you.
With their wills on it.
I'd like to say thank you very much, Eric, for the award. And I'd like to say thank you to all the people that have stuck by this band through thick and thin.
Especially me and Brian.
And to all the people that took the piss, the joke's on you. Thank you very much.
Congratulations to the Rolling Stones. We're all excited about it here too, guys.
Eric, you've just had the job of presenting the Stones with their Lifetime's Achievement Grammy via satellite. Were you a bit nervous about that, were you?
Very, very nervous, yes.
Now, you said that to you, the Rolling Stones are what rock and roll is all about.
Absolutely.
What does that mean?
Well, the other night, there was a memorial tribute to Ian Stewart in the 100 Club. And I haven't seen the Stones play live in a club for 15 years, I don't think. And when Keith kicked it off, it took me back to what it's all about. Really is just power and making it right, you know, on the stage. I don't know how you can do that unless your soul is in it. I think they found that out too the other night. They really do feel good together. They are a fantastic band.
Because there was talk in the late 60s, after Brian Jones died, that you were to be asked to join the group. Did that ever occur?
That was right when I was trying to put Blind Faith together. I should have done it, I think, anyway, because I really love those guys. It's lovely to be part of a band.
Yeah. Despite appearances, this is not a mobile homeowners convention. This is Soundstage 6 at Elstree Studios. It's May the 1st, 1986, the sun is shining and the Rolling Stones are making a video.
5, 6, 7, 8. One more! From the Bob D. That's it. Yeah? And then, arms up. Pa, pa, pa. Pa, pa, pa. Yeah, but you have to keep your elbows up, darling. The elbow should be in the same line with your shoulder and the arm straight. 5, 6, 7, 8. One more from the body. One more straight from the heart.
Russell, is this your first Rolling Stones video?
I worked with Mick once before, but it's the first time with the band, yeah.
Do you think they're natural video artists?
Well, they've been filmed so many times. I talked to Mick at lunchtime about some other videos they've done, and I think a lot of the videos that he's done have gone back into obscurity. I mean, they've done so many.
Yeah.
And all of them have been different.
You know, it would take a long time to go from there to there. I mean, otherwise you're running, and I don't think that really looks
right. I agree.
You're more or less bounding, you might see a turn and go up.
Yes. We pick a take up and you come back down.
Yeah.
We try to get away from the normal gloss that a lot of videos and probably a lot of mine tend to go towards, and give this one like a rawness and a hard edge quality and a bit of a violent sort of, nearly a bad quality.
Is this an expensive video as they go?
No. I mean, big is not necessarily expensive. It's not a very detailed set. It's a set that actually is done with broad strokes, and actually that is quite a reasonably economic video, this one.
So you're hoping to get it all done today?
Yeah, it's all about, 3 a.m. I'd like to run the whole song. Yeah, we're only using very small bits of this, but it'd be good just to run the whole thing through and see what happens.
Yeah. Here we go for a rehearsal with playback and roll playback.
Well,
when
I first came to Barbados 7 years ago, this is where Jerry and I ended up, in this house for a holiday. It was kind of, this is the quiet side of the island. There's not many tourists here.
Without being rude, this doesn't look like the top end of the market.
It's the shishi end of the damn market.
I say, what sort of money are we talking about for a
thing they gave it to us.
Oh, really? But they wouldn't be charging much anyway.
I don't think so.
You have a reputation for not throwing your money around.
Well, I mean, I don't like to give gold sovereigns to doormans, but I mean, I think you should be generous with people that haven't got it. You don't have to be generous with people who want to rip you off.
But you're a bit careful. You argue with shop assistants and things like that.
No, that's a horrible habit.
Hello, what you got? Cornet? Rum raisin?
I have a pineapple cornet, please.
How many more? No.
Any more for any more?
Pineapple cornet. Eric, got vanilla cup.
Well done. Through.
Everything Mick gave him, Charlie Watts put into this ice cream, floating ice cream parlour. Apart from the obvious thing of being the singer and the chap up front,
yeah.
What role do you perform with the Rolling Stones?
Well, I got lots of roles, apart from being a singer. No, I mean writer. I started off doing lyric writing very early on, and then I moved on to writing melodies as well as lyrics.
Yeah. I mean, do you write on your own nowadays, and Keith writes on his own?
Yeah, we've always done that, actually, until the, apart from the very early ones. A bit of both. And then it's all kind of the organisation thing that I started to do after Andrew Oldham, I suppose. We had Alan Klein, but he wasn't really a person that was on the spot all the time. And yeah. I started doing organising and things like that. 1969, we started opening our first office and stuff like that.
Do you enjoy that?
No, a lot of it I find tedious.
I mean, how are decisions made for the Rolling Stones?
Well, the idea is shoved up, and it's either taken or it isn't, you know, on a more or less democratic basis. I mean, obviously, it's like anything else. People have to be sometimes convinced to do things and sometimes not.
Yeah, yeah. So, let's talk for a moment about your... you made a solo record,
yeah.
She's the Boss, which
yeah.
was a... How do you assess that in retrospect? Are you pleased with the success it had, or do you wish it'd been more successful?
Well, everyone wants their stuff to be more successful. I mean, it did on the par with the Rolling Stones' last three records. It sold about the same, so yeah. on that level. But I mean, that's not really the reason I did it, to make a huge record, make millions and millions of dollars. I mean, I wanted to have a bit of a laugh outside the band so that I wouldn't be always putting ideas to committee.
Yeah.
Because that's what a band is, it's a committee. And you know, you probably, everyone knows what that's like.
Yeah.
And it is a committee. You know, democracy is a very difficult way to run music. It takes, and that's why records and all that take a lot of time, and that's why you have inevitable disagreements. People want to do one thing, another person wants to do another. So, that inevitably people argue in bands because people want to do different things, especially when you've done the initial thing that you set out to do, which is to be
successful.
A successful
yeah.
band. So then you've done that, right? And you've been doing it very, very successfully until what? So what else do you want to say? So it's in a way, it's kind of interesting. It's fun to go in a studio and just have your own ideas and let them flow in any way you want.
Yeah, yeah.
Rather than always going to the committee and saying, please, would you do this or do you like that? Which is another way of making records. It's a very good way because both ways are valid in my mind. Because one way it's your stuff and musicians bouncing off like in a band. The other way, it's very much one person's idea.
This new record, how do you rate it in the range of Rolling Stones records? God knows how many there have been.
I don't know. I mean, I couldn't rate them. I'm not a rater. I mean, it's a very good album, I think. I'm not sure how it compares with, say, Aftermath. I mean, it's a very, very different album to that, or Beggar's Banquet, or Satanic Majesties. Or, I mean, they're all very, very different.
How do you feel about Satanic Majesties?
Love it.
Which is
the
one that everybody always says is an embarrassment.
Lovely records.
What's your favourite track?
Gompa? 2,000 light years from home.
I see. You don't look back on that as an appalling mistake.
No. There should be a few more mistakes like that, I think.
Yeah. Do you think it'd be better if you were able to make mistakes?
Yeah.
Nowadays?
I think it'd be much nicer to be a bit more. If I've got criticism of the Rolling Stones, that is, and myself, because I think it applies to me as much as anyone. That they're a little bit cautious, you know. And,
yeah.
But I mean, that rock music is rather cautious. Even the most experimental people are cautious. Who is he? What does Mick Jagger do?
He sings.
Who is?
Yeah, get out.
Go on, Rolling go on. Stones. The Rolling Stones.
Double the drums.
Is that a new? That's one of the new ones. The name's not on it. Oh yeah.
You ain't gonna see it.
No.
I was in a band in South London called the Cliftons. We were playing black R&B music at the time, Little Richard, Fats Domino, Coasters, Lloyd Price, that kind of music, which is, it wasn't rock and roll, it was more R&B at that time, because rock and roll thought of in England was Cliff Richard, Marty Wilde, all those kind of people. And then you had all the terrible showbizzy people who were making records, like Dickie Valentine and, you know, you name them, David Whitfield and Alma Cogan and like Lita Rosa. multitudes of them. And we were trying to do something a bit more soulful down in South London. It wasn't going down too well because they always kept asking us for Foot Tapper by the Shadows and, you know, all that kind of thing. And Cliff's latest records. But there was an interest in American stuff, stuff like Jerry Lee Lewis and that. In England, Elvis, of course. We did sort of merge into that. And my drummer answered an ad he saw in a paper, because it kind of fell through after about a year and a half. We weren't getting anywhere. We were doing all right, but nothing amazing, no amazing gigs. And he answered an ad for a R&B group, and he came up and he met Keith, Mick, Brian, and Ian Stewart, who'd had bits of a band together for 6 months, 5 months, actually. With odd people sort of filling in. Charlie had filled in on odd occasions. He was playing with Alexis Corner, and Mick Avery had played one gig, I think, who later joined the Kinks, and so on like that. And Dick Taylor, of course, who formed the Pretty Things later. And he came back and he said, they haven't got a bass player, and it's quite slow blues music, and it's quite easy to play and interesting, so when you go up. So we came trundle up in the snow with all my equipment. I had a Vox AC30, which was gold dust in those days for somebody who wasn't in a professional band, you know. I had a small reverb and a small amp, and I had this huge wardrobe that I built for bass with an 18-inch speaker in it, and it had concrete in the bottom, and it was like a great big wardrobe, and it took four people to carry it. It was so heavy, because someone told me if you put concrete in the bottom you get real good bass sounds, you know, so I did that. And I sent away and built a little amp, a 25-watt amplifier, you know, from sort of radio and retailer or something, one of those weekly magazines. And we fixed all that up, and I used to get electric shocks off that. Every time you plugged into it, you know, put the plug in, you used to get shocks, and I was putting it in your foot and blew up in the end.
So where did this audition take place?
Wetherby Arms. It's a pub. It used to be up here on the, in World's End, just up the bend there.
In Chelsea?
Yeah, because they lived in Edith Grove, which is the next road up, which goes across. It's the road down from the airport where all the traffic go. three of them. Terrible flat, you know, really
this is Mick
disgusting
Keith.
Flat. Yeah, Mick, Keith and Brian, with another sort of ne'er-do-well person called Felge.
There's somebody who subsequently turned up as half of Nanka Felge, or they borrowed his name.
They just used the name, yeah. As that was group writing. And although people said at the time Nanka and Felge was Mick and Keith, it wasn't, it was the band, writing as a band. So Nanka was that face they used to pull, like Quasimodo, sort of, all the reporters.
What sort of people were they at that time? What do you think of them?
They just bummed fags off you all the time, and money and that, you know. They didn't have anything, so you became a receptacle for passing sort of food and belongings to them.
You had a job, didn't you?
Yeah, well, I had a family. I had responsibilities at home, and Charlie was working. Ian Stewart was working, giving them lunch and vouchers from ICI, where he used to work. He used to cycle up there to save money. From Cheam, and Mick was at the London School of Economics. He had a grant, so he used to split that. And all you ever did there was just keep giving them fags, buying them beers, buying them fish and chips, meat pies, and just keep going and giving them shillings to put in the gas meter to keep the flat warm, because it was one of the coldest winters, 1962. Going into 63 was really a bad winter, and they were on starvation level. They used to lay in bed all the time because they didn't see any reason for getting out of bed, because there was nothing to do. And they'd get cold, so they thought they might as well stay in bed. They were sort of semi-mad at that time, I think.
So what was your estimate of how long this group would last at the time you joined them?
There was something about the band that I liked, you know, something quite raw and... I mean, it was just totally unique. To me, we're living in South London, I thought of them as what we and Hancock and people like that, comedians at that time, thought of as beatniks. I didn't know what a beatnik was. I'd never met one. So when I met them, I really thought they were what was called beatniks because they had long hair, they had scruffy clothes, long jumpers, you know. They just looked totally wrong, you know, and in a fascinating kind of way. And I wanted to be part of it. When I used to arrive in my Teddy Boy drainpipe trousers, they always used to take the piss. And...
So anyway, you started making records. And had a certain amount of success. I see you've got an old poster on the wall over there for one of the early package tours. What was that like?
That got mad in a physical way with fans and all that. But before that, the year and a half or 2 years of clubs and small ballrooms was unbelievable because we'd just turn up in this van. Just all climb out of this van, all carry the gear in, which was an assortment of odds and sods, you know, bodged up stuff, when everybody else had all the same amps and all the same colour guitars, the same uniforms, makeup, the hair done all the same, you know, and they'd all do walking. And we used to bring out these three rusty stools out of the van and used to set them up on stage around Mick. Mick used to stand on the mic. Me, Brian and Keith would sit on the stools with a beer. We'd have a sort of amp next to you so you could put your beer on and your fag. And we used to smoke and drink beer, no uniforms, long hair, and Charlie'd be over there. And that's where we'd do it. We'd play a song and we'd stop and we'd have a beer and we'd have a chat and then we'd play another song. It was like rehearsal time and ignoring the audience. And they must have found it fascinating too. It was quite extraordinary when everybody else was doing all that other kind of stuff. So yeah. There was a real fascination there for people looking at us, as there was when I first met them. You know.
Looking back over the 25 years, what were the high points and what were the low points?
Low points is when all the drug busts were going on, I suppose. He didn't know whether who was going to be in jail what week and who was going to be in the studio. It was like that. And when we all went to France because we couldn't afford to live in England anymore. We'd been a number one band for 8 years and suddenly we had no money. And we didn't own anything that was supposed to belong to us and we owed the tax man a lot of money, which we thought was paid, so we had to leave. And then we were accused of being like tax exiles, money, you know, reaping the benefits. It's the only thing we could do. Otherwise, pack up, you know, and become a taxi driver or something. That was a bit of a downer because I didn't really want to live in France, but I had no alternative.
So what about the high points?
My magic moments are more like the end of a tour. When you all have a big hug and say, thanks, mate, thanks for playing great guitar, and Charlie, thank you, man, for those offbeats, and that's the nice times, you know.
Just about there?
Yeah.
Well, thanks, Bridget. Do you like that down? Do you have that down? Yeah.
Yeah.
What's that sound?
You're Russell.
A problem. I have a problem.
Problem?
Yeah.
You have problems?
I've got to stick this boot on.
Oh, put some hairspray on the boot.
What's the foot?
I don't need some. Yeah, I didn't get any of that. I don't need that.
Do you want me to stick it on?
It's spray case, it's not most. So just kill it out.
No, I didn't have one spray in the first place.
Here, look, here, this side.
No, I have another problem.
Russell?
What are you shooting?
Jane? This rubber bit's coming off my boot and I can't grip on that ramp.
Okay.
Or
super glue bill.
Get my sneakers sprayed up, grey, black. And give them to me. I'll need them.
First time I went on stage with them was June the 1st, my birthday, 75. And I had to learn about 150 numbers in a couple of months. You know.
Was that tough?
Yeah, it was...
Who taught you them? Did you sit there with Keith and be taught them?
Yeah, because although I was aware of the songs from the records, I'd never actually sit down and played the chords, you know. Everyone thinks the Stones are like three-chord merchants, and they nearly are. But the other ones that they throw in are pretty tricky, you know.
So, Chance, show us. You just happen to have a guitar at hand there.
Oh. Oh, dear. What do you want to know? Which one?
Well, the idea that they throw in an odd chord. I mean, this is something that Mick was saying the other week, that Stone songs are not as conventional as you might think on the face of it.
Yeah, it was something like... say Honky Tonk Women or something, you know, it would go like... you know, the verse like... Yeah.
Still a matter of just two interlocking guitars in the Rolling Stones.
Yeah, that's something that Keith and I have always luckily had from the start. We never plan as such exactly what we are going to do individually. We have a knack of, if one goes this way, the other one will slide in this way. Yes. It's like if a solo comes up on a certain number, we don't even look at each other. If I want to take the solo, I'll take it, right? And if he wants to take it, he'll take it.
Really? You leave it as loose as that?
Oh, yeah.
Are there ever any nights when neither of you take it?
Yeah, that's when he's knocked me out, or I've knocked him out, physically. Now, he would certainly tell me if he didn't want, if, you know, if he particularly wanted to take the solo and make certain song, I mean, without any messing about, he'd let you know.
So how did these riffs come about? I mean, if that's something like on one hit. I mean, how did that first start? It started as a guitar.
Oh, it started with Keith.
Yeah. What did he do? What did he first come up with?
Well, he'd be sitting there and he'd go, can you move these plants? He would say,
right? I'm sure he would.
I think it's in B.
I was going to say, I thought it was in B. And then what do you come in?
But it might start with, like, it might be going like, you know. You just throw it around, you get different rhythms, and you ended up like... I did play acoustic on that song.
Yeah. Do you ever feel after sort of 11 years I have along with the Rolling Stones that you've played every guitar part like that there is to play?
Yeah. Chuck Berry, when I saw him last year, he said to me, ain't none of us doing anything that Mozart ain't already done. Yeah, that's true.
People say this is Keith's record.
Yeah, I know.
You wouldn't care to respond to that.
No, it's a Rolling Stones record. But everybody has to put in their max at the end. It's just a matter of when. With the people that arrived in Paris and Mick wasn't there for a few nights, and so they sort of say, Keith, they're pulling the shots, you know, but only sort of grossly exaggerated. It's just winding the band up, you know.
The impression given, though, is that you're the man that winds the band up.
Yeah, well, I guess, I mean, in that respect, I guess I am, but I always am, you know, for that, because, you know, with the guitars and the drums, and I mean, I have to play, and I have to get them to play, you know, so that Mick has something decent to sing to, you know, really. I mean, I am the winder-upper in that respect, yeah.
The impression given is that they're four chaps who've got hobbies and so forth and other obvious parts of their life, whereas you're the bloke who lives for the Rolling Stones.
Yeah, I guess. It's not that I don't have any other interests, obviously, after all, I've got a family and kids, and but I don't know, I don't spend my time doing fret work or anything. But I guess, no, I really enjoy playing with the Stones. I've played with loads of other people too, you know. And as good as any of the other people are, what I really enjoy doing, the way I think that I can put across whatever it is I do, I can do it best through the Stones, you know.
Would it be true to say that your life changed after 1977 when you were arrested in Toronto for a possession of heroin?
It's very difficult for me to talk about what I was like before the Toronto incident, because I, you know, it is all a bit of a haze to me. I mean, if I want to know what I did certain in those years, I have to ask Bill Wyman.
Who keeps the archives?
Yeah, and he'll say, oh, you were out of it, man. I guess so, you know.
How long were you out of it for?
It's difficult to say. When I was working, I would be straight, you know, and I'd clean up for tours. And in retrospect, I guess a real problem I had was adrenaline, you know. I mean, I could never come down off of a tour, you know. I mean, I'd go home, everybody would disappear, and I'd be, and my body would be saying, where's the next gig, you know, where's, and then it would just keep on going, and all I'd know what would happen, and I'd eventually go back to the stuff again just to calm down, you know, and, I mean, I've eventually grown to deal with that in the last 9 years, because it's been a long time since, you know, it's been a long time since I got into that, and I sort of forget about it, you know. Unless, I mean, I'm well aware that it all went on, but it's very different for me. I guess I've grown up some.
What's your relationship like with the other Stones nowadays? When you all get together, does it just click straight away?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, the only family up until recently that I've had for a while, you know, yeah. I mean, they're the constant ones, you know.
We've read a great deal about your relationship with Mick recently, that you want to go on tour and Mick doesn't want to go on tour, yeah. And that's the cause of tension. Is that the case?
Yeah, but, I mean, you don't do a gig like this without having fights occasionally. This one just happens to pop out into public, you know. Yeah, I thought the Stones should go on the road this year. But as I say, I'm a selfish guy. That's what I really like to do. So, I mean, I was just sort of pushing my own thing in there. But at the same time, if somebody doesn't want to do it, you know, you can't force them, you know, and because you wouldn't be doing the audience a favour or the band, you know, everybody's got to want to do it.
Seems to be some rather violent material on this record. I'm thinking particularly of songs like Fight.
Yes, yeah, but, I mean, there always has been on Stones album. I mean, the music lends itself to that. From Street Fighting Man, you know, Too Much Blood, or, you know, it's a theme that runs through life, and it's themes that runs through our music, I suppose, you know.
Don't you ever stop and think, isn't this rather distasteful?
Well, of course it's distasteful, you know, especially if you're on the receiving end. But,
I mean, to sing about it.
Well, but I mean, if you sort of stop to singing about things because they're distasteful, you're reduced to sort of singing about embroidery. Nice Ming China.
You don't think you've occasionally been guilty of relishing it rather too much?
I don't think, no. I don't think anybody could be accused of relishing the violence. It's, we'd be doing ourselves and the audience a disfavor, you know. We wouldn't be doing them a favor by ignoring it. You know, I mean, I think one of the things the Stones have always done is sort of laid it out there as kind of as we see it, you know.
Roll playback. Turn over.
Videos. Do you enjoy this bit of the job?
Well, doing these things?
Yeah.
No, not really. I think they're a waste of time, actually.
But you sort of go along with it because it's a good idea to sell a lot of records?
Well, we're told, aren't we, by the industry, this is the way to sell records.
Let's talk about your other career. Apart from the Rolling Stones, you run...
Other career?
The Charlie Watts Big Band.
Oh,
or orchestra. Same. What do we call it? Tell us about it.
What?
Tell us about the Charlie Watts Big Band.
That's what it is.
And is it's a really large band, isn't it? It brings together...
it's enormous. It's called Self-Indulgence.
Does it cost you a great deal of money to run that?
It did do, to start with. It doesn't now.
Are you pleased at the success that's had?
Well, yeah. It's nice. People want to listen to saxophone players. And...
does it take a great deal of adjusting when you come to play with the Rolling Stones after doing something like that?
It's the same thing, really.
Well, really?
Yeah. You have to play the drums, isn't it? As well as you can.
How long can you see the Rolling Stones keeping going for?
As long as someone wheels you out, I think. I really don't. I mean, I thought... when I joined them, I thought there's another 6 months. 3 years was the longest I'd been with bands, you see.
What are you doing between...
goes on and on.
What are you doing between making records?
Nothing.
I understand you collect things.
Yeah, that's easy though, isn't it?
You have great enthusiasms outside the Rolling Stones.
Oh, yeah.
But is it possibly true to say that other members of the group don't have those in the same way? That they're more devoted to the group than you are, or is that not true?
I don't know. I don't know. What do you mean? I don't follow that.
Well, the other members of the Rolling Stones, for them, the Rolling Stones are more important than
well,
the
Well, I do have a life outside of them, but I always have had. But I think they've got a life outside. I don't really look at... the name Rolling Stone don't mean anything to me.
What do you mean by that?
Well, it doesn't mean anything to me. I mean, it's just Keith and Mick, Ronnie and Bill.
What would be your attitude if there was to be talk of going on tour in the near future? What do you mean, shameless?
My attitude? I don't know. I mean, again, you know, if they said we're on the road, that's it. I don't know, really. I mean, obviously, you get involved in it, setting it up and all that, but, I mean, it's a lot of work, RLTs.
It's not something you relish.
What?
Going on tour.
It's just, it's work, isn't it? I mean, I just don't think about it, actually. Best not to. But I mean, dead years ago, I thought about it.
Thanks very much.
It's quite hard work. So, as you noticed today, I mean, what have we done? Nothing. Except sit around.
You must have done a great deal of hanging about in 25 years of the Rolling Stones.
Hmm. Work 5 years and 20 years hanging around.
Just one hit. It ain't enough for me.